Good afternoon and welcome to the Sheboygan County Historical Museum. Today is the 29th of August 2012 and it is a very, very special day. Today is all about the Reuben Gold Thwaites Award. It's the top and most prestigious award that's given out by the Wisconsin Historical Society to one of the 380 affiliates of the State Historical Society. And for 1 year, we are that historical society. So you're going to meet lots of people today and see lots of exhibits and see lots of things going on. And we'll wind it up with a special program and presentation a little bit later this evening. The basic message with all the museums is that we collect, we preserve, and educate. And you see pictures here behind me about all those things. And we do it here at the museum too. And we collect things, we store things, we preserve things. But the most fun is the education part. We have holiday memories, full-day student education programs, third Saturdays, and lots more. Again, welcome to the Sheboygan County Historical Museum.
I'm John Posowitz. I'm the lead elf for the annual Christmas show, Prangy Windows Displays of Yesteryear. Kind of all starts with my sketchbook here. Sit down, put together a few ideas, make a few sketches for something we want to have in the show this coming year. I often make drawings of our plans, so we have some idea of color and where we're going to go with these ideas. I also, from time to time, went out last year before this and took pictures of some old homes in Sheboygan, which we created part of our display. Right here is a book that from years back, designing a little train that went around the Christmas tree in our lobby. But all these ideas go down, they get changed a lot, but eventually we get something that's quite presentable. We'll take a step over here and look at some of the pictures that we have of various displays in the recent past. We've got a few pictures on the wall here today of some of the recent past. So here, this is the picture of the little Victorian homes we built. That was shown in 2011. We've also got Romy's Bakery making gingerbread cookies, and that was a part of that display as well. We've also got here, one that came down the stairs, this is Santa's Castle with all the elves and everything going on around it. That was a lot of fun to build that, and it looked pretty nice. Going back to 2010, here's the display. Children all nestled in their bed, visions of sugar plums, and some of the adjacent features. This little scene over here got the train that goes around the Christmas tree. And here, like the Victorian homes a few years down the road, here's some of the storefronts. We had a city street scene, and we had little trucks, and all of these figures in here was like a Christmas parade going down Old 8th Street. This one is Santa on the roof greeting the people as they came in the lobby the other year. Children watching the clatter on the front lawn with all the reindeer and Santa's sled. A little beyond this, now we got night 2009. Here's a picture of some of the things what are inside Prangy's store. This is the actual popcorn machine from the popcorn department, and those of us that have been there can still smell that popcorn. The whole store smelled like popcorn. This is one of my favorites, the group of raccoons in a tree, and here's Red Riding Hood directing a little orchestra and bears singing. We call that the about the Kettle Moraine Symphonic Singers. Here's some little storefronts we built that same year. This one is a quilt shop. Over here is a doll shop. This one was a toy shop. Little Prangy figures building toys. These are little mechanical characters that were doing that. On the quilt shop one, there's a little lady running a sewing machine. Here's another big picture of the crew putting together some of the H.C. Prangy's and Art Image storefronts, along with the tall security bank building, the way it used to look. This was a favorite display, too, of the simulated Garten Toy Factory. This machine was building some of the classic Garten cars. And here's the crew working on. Here it turns to be about 7 raccoons playing the role of the workers. So it's a regular Santa's workshop. Here's one of the big products that Garten made, the Snowflake Snow Disc. That was real popular, and the standard sleds. They made a lot of sleds in the old days. Now we're going to reposition here. Let's see, what have we got here? This is a part of the... you're not ready yet. Okay. This is a part of the street scene. Here's an elf. Some of the figures. This is the Boys and Girls Club float in the 8th Street Parade. This is one of my all-time favorites. Here are the sock monkeys. Sock monkeys are getting pretty popular, but all these monkeys were sitting on ladders that were swinging back and forward. They were decorating the trees and purposefully not doing a very good job of it. So Elaine Stoltenberg, who has since passed on, spent a lot of time making a lot of things for us, and we kind of think of her every year when we go through this program. This is me having a good time putting together a little house. And let's see. Okay. This is a little bit before.
Again, good afternoon. And John did the more recent years of holiday memories, and I'm here to take you back through the earliest years that we've had. So we're going to pick up right here in 2006. And 2006 was a very special program called The Littlest Angel, and it was all animated. These were very, very fragile. We worked with them over several months and put together that particular story. That's a primary story that year. This is 2005 that we have here. And again, you'll see all kinds of new exhibits here. We got the Grand Central Junction there with the water tower. And we focused in on some of the railroad cars that we have in the collection of the Prangy animation, and it's some of the elves and train people, and Santa Claus has got a train suit on. It was great fun that year as well. In 2004, it was all about forest creatures and forest homes, and so the primary part of 2004 were these tree trunks right here. Not only were they one story, they were two story. There was a family on each one, and some of the families were raccoons, some were skunks, some were opossums, but they're all families having a great time as they prepared and enjoyed Christmas holidays. the next year, before that was 2003. In 2003, it was called a candy construction Christmas, and we had great fun with that too. You'll see a railroad up here again, but look at all the candy pieces and lights that are on there. And Nancy, who works here at the museum, is right there with a couple of the elves with that small little engine. The next picture down is with the crane, and that crane would swing left to right, and the boom would move. It was great fun there as well, as it would swing out to where people were standing. This was a big piece to work with, but it turned out very, very well. The bottom one includes a cement truck and another little crane. We had some other pieces there too. But this was just a very, very fun Christmas to put together and for our guests to enjoy. For 2002, the first two pictures up here is a school scene. Those are called dolls of old. And we had those on display in school scenes, and the kids are in desks, different kinds of dolls from a long time ago, and a kitchen, more of a kitchen scene over here. And the bottom pictures, we focused in on fairy tales, three fairy tales, and the three bears was one, and I'm stuck. Let's start with that one again. Can we do that? In 2002, we have Dolls of Old. Part of it is in a school scene over here. This is more of a kitchen scene here. That was great fun. And then we focused in on three fairy tales. So Three Bears, Pied Piper, and Hansel and Gretel. That was the fun for this year with our other main exhibit by the entryway with Mr. and Mrs. Santa Claus over here. The big thing about 2001, that was our very, very first year. It was the first time we had a chance to work with the animation. We're working with animation that had been donated to the museum by Yonkers at that point in time. And so this was all brand new to us. And the special features this year included the bears. We had bears and more bears. And we had Santa Claus, of course, and a family there. And we had some students in the school setting as well. And one little elf right out there, right as you walked into the museum. That was our first year, a very special year. But what I like to talk about with all of the years is that every year has been different. Every year is a brand new show, different theme, and just great, great fun.
Hi, a function that we have at our museum every month is our Third Saturdays, which is held actually on the third Saturday of the month. They usually run from 10 o'clock until 3 o'clock. We started a pilot one in 2006, which was circuses, and then we started doing one each month starting in the year 2007. Our next month we will have our 59th Third Saturday, and we have always we've never repeated a theme, but we have continued on. We have a committee that works with us in deciding themes and what ones we're going to cover each year. We get resource people in that know a lot of the topic and help us. We have big pictures that we display, and we also have often have DVDs or videos that we show on the topic. They are very, very well attended, and people are always interested in what we have. It's often fun to see the resource people that we have coming in during the third Saturday. They are like a family, and they like to visit with each other and learn from each other also. So it's always a very nice learning experience for the families and for the adults who come on the third Saturdays. The last few years we have done videos in January of things in the Sheboygan area, and then our October one is very, very successful, and that is when we do collections. And there we have people who have different collections in the county come in and share their collections. We're always looking forward to hearing new ideas and new topics that we can try to find information on. So if you have any ideas, feel free to call us and share them with us.
Hi, I'm Angie Holland, part of the education staff here at the Sheboygan County Historical Museum. We currently have three full-day education program offerings, one on Native Americans, one on pioneers of Sheboygan County, and one on trades and occupations of the mid-1800s. The education programs include full-day sessions where the students come right in the morning, they hop on the bus from school and come right here to the museum, and then they spend the entire day here doing gallery sessions, critical thinking activities, and hands-on activities, which are one of the big highlights for a lot of the students and teachers. Here on the table in front of me, I have one of the hands-on activities that we use for our trades and occupations program, where we talk about the job of the miller, which was really important in a community that was growing wheat. The wheat had to have a place where it could be milled. And so we have a little model mill for the students to use. They see how the mill, the grain gets dumped into the hopper. Then another student acts as kind of the water power, because the grain would have been powered by a water wheel, and they turn the mill. What happens here is that the millstones within the mill are grinding the wheat together, and they come up with some ground up flour. Our mill is a little bit on the fritz right now, so some of the wheat kernels are staying whole, but what they do next is they find that the grain needs to be sorted, the flour needs to be sorted. So they dump it into the sorter, and then a student will take the, I'm just gonna step right through here, will turn the crank and sort the flour that they have just ground. And then when the students open up the drawers, they see that there are different grades of flour. There's very fine flour that would be used for cake, a little bit coarser flour that would be used for bread, even coarser, I don't even know if we can call that flour anymore, that could be used kind of for cereal. And then in the very last, we have stuff that would either need to be reground or fed to chickens. So when the students are here doing activities such as this, they're learning about how all these jobs were important when communities were forming and how each job kind of depended on other jobs within the community. So when he gets to you, then you'll just be carving away at the piece of wood, okay? What you're watching Marissa, our young helper, doing right now is she's shaving a piece of wood sitting on a special bench called a Schnitzelbank. This is another activity that the students do when they come for our trades and occupations full day program. The draw knife that she's holding, as well as the Schnitzelbank that she's sitting on, are two of the tools that would have been used by the job of the cooper. Cooper isn't a word that we think of much as a job anymore, but it used to be very important. The coopers were the ones who created containers such as barrels, buckets, tubs, which were vital in the days before they had plastic to make containers and other modern materials that we use today. So we're getting a lot of help from Marissa this evening. She's now working on one of our kind of more experimental hands-on activities. It's for a new program that we're developing for a full-day program at the museum on the Civil War and the home front in Sheboygan County. What life was like for Sheboygan County citizens during the time of the Civil War. One of the things that was a fact of life back then was that, you know, the war was going on. Everybody knew it. Everybody knew someone who was in the war, and so war was something that was on people's minds. And it actually became a popular toy. A lot of toys were kind of military-based. So one of the activities that we're thinking of doing is having the students make their own toy drum to take back to school with them after the program is done. So Marissa's helping us experiment with the different kinds of materials and methods that we're going to use, having the kids make their drums. Another of our programs is called the Native Americans of Sheboygan County. And in that program, we spend the entire morning talking about how things from nature were really important to the survival of the Native Americans who lived in this area before the arrival of Europeans around in the 1700s. So nature, natural materials, are our big focus for that part of the day. We have the students make baskets, which we show them a number of different baskets that are made from natural materials, and then they get a chance to actually weave their own basket that each class will get a basket to take back to school with them. So we show them the method of kind of weaving over and then dropping the piece that they had, grabbing the next one, and weaving it over. Dropping it, grabbing the next piece, and weaving it over. And the students really get a kick out of that. They, especially, you know, after doing it a few times, they really get the hang of it, and they get into a good groove. And when the bell rings telling them that it's time to go to their next station, they're usually kind of disappointed that they have to stop the weaving. But they do a great job with that, and it's just another way to kind of show them that all the things that you would need to survive could be found in nature if you had an innovative mind to figure out how to use them. The toy that I'm holding in my hand here, we call it a whirligig or a buzzsaw. These types of toys were pretty popular in the 1800s because they could be made out of common household materials. You could just use an extra button from your mom's sewing basket and some string, and you could make this buzzing toy, which you could do all sorts of movements with. You could get really fancy if you were better at it than I am. Students or kids could draw designs on the button, and just it would be a pretty simple toy, but something to kind of pass the time after chores were done. Speaking of chores, one thing that kids would have to help their parents with in the 1800s, especially if you were a farming family, would be to create candles. So one of the things that we have our students do when they come for our Pioneers of Sheboygan County program is they actually get to dip candles into hot wax. We take safety precautions so that no one gets hurt or burned. But what the students do is they'll take a little wheel of candles that have been started. These are kind of thin right now, but we'll add on one more layer of wax. And we do that over and over again until the candles are the size that they could actually be used. Then each student gets to take one of these candles back to school with them as kind of a memento of the day. What I just tapped out there in the Morse code that was used during the 1860s was hi. And a part of our new program that we're going to be starting coming up this fall with the Civil War program that we're still developing we're going to be talking about how communication was so important during the time of war, both for strategy and also for delivering news to people back home who were anxious about what was happening with their loved ones who were soldiers on the front. So the students will get a chance to use a little telegraph machine and learn about how that was a really important part of people's lives during the Civil War.
My name is Tamara Lang, and I'm the collection coordinator and registrar here at the museum. I have a variety of duties here that I perform, but a lot of them are related to the maintenance and the care of the collection here. What I'm demonstrating and working on right now is actually our labeling process for objects. All objects that come in here to the museum have a number assigned to them, goes according to the donation and then the number of items in the donation. Those numbers are actually put onto the objects in some way, shape, or form. Sometimes they're sewn in, sometimes they're put on with a museum approved method that's standard museum protocol, and sometimes it's done with tags. that actually corresponds to information that we have in our database so that we can track those objects, where they are, their condition, and what they look like throughout the years. What I'm working on right now is actually an autographed baseball, which is kind of a challenge. Because the baseball actually has autographs all over it, it really doesn't have any good location that I could put a physical number on it, such as what I did with this button here, which was a political button. This is actually just a temporary tag. This will be taken off. But this is the permanent number, which has been put on with a combination of salivar and gesso, which is part of our museum protocol that we use here. Now at this point, because this is dried and it's on there permanently, I could actually take my temporary tag off. This, however, doesn't have a situation where I can essentially, for lack of a better term, paint a number on it. So the first thing that I've done is actually put a loop here with a really high quality strong thread where I ran it through an actual stitch. So essentially, I've put a stitch into a stitch for this baseball. Now that I have that in there, I'm going to be able to take this and actually pull out what I have here are acid-free tags. And again, really high quality polyester thread. So what we do, we take an acid-free pen, we put the number on that tag, our number is here, our temporary number. Making sure that it's highly legible for the next person. I'm actually going to take this tag, pick it up, tie it. One of the biggest things with numbering is that we want to make sure that it's reversible. In a lot of ways, that's the kind of the protocol with everything here at the museum that relates to the collection. We want to do things that are reversible if methods change down the road. So now that I have this loop in here, I'm actually going to take my tag, and you'll notice that that loop is pretty loose. I could cut that off if I had to, and I wouldn't run any risk of damaging that baseball. And now I'm going to be able to take this tag, run it back through itself, kind of cinch it down. I can cut my extra little bits off here, cut my extra pieces off down here. And this now has its number attached to it. It could be put into storage, or it could be put out on display real easily. I can still show the various parts, and it's not really getting in the way of the actual artifact. Now, this number in theory, or this artifact in theory, would still need to be entered into our database here. This is what we use. We use a program called Past Perfect. It's one of the most popular in the museum industry, particularly for smaller size museums. We use this program where we can enter our description, we can enter all the date range, we can actually enter photographs as well for objects, along with all kinds of additional information, including condition reports, dimensions, and people. For example, all the names on this will have the people put into it. The other thing that happens with these objects is that they actually come over and then they are photographed. And we basically use a high quality digital photograph. We put something like this on here. We would make sure in this case, we actually need to make sure we get a scale on. The number goes on. Again, not the best written right here, but. And then we would start taking photographs. With something like this, it's a little bit more difficult. We'll probably have to take somewhere between 4 and 6 photographs to get every part of it documented. And then those are also uploaded into our database. At that point, they're ready for storage. A location could be recorded. It also would be ready for display. If we put it out on display, the same thing would happen. We would record where we're putting it out there. So that's part of what my job here at the museum is. I also work a lot with the exhibits and also with other preservation kinds of things, including people that are interested in doing things. Some of the items that you see as we kind of move here to the left relate to that. For example, what you're looking at right now is actually my exhibit cart. Sounds a little bit crazy, but I can haul this pretty much anywhere I need to here in the museum and even out to other buildings if I have to.
And it has the basic tools that I need to install just about any exhibit. There might be a couple things, but there's an awful lot on this cart that it saves me tons of trips back and forth to the workshop. And in fact, if you look at this picture in the lower left here, you can see the cart there in the picture in the middle of the exhibit installation. It just rolls out along with everything, and it's super handy. Of course, a lot of what I do too relates to the preservation of the objects here, whether that be in storage, here on display, or actually helping people with their own things. What we're looking at here is a chair that we've used Renaissance wax on. This is what we actually recommend for historic wooden artifacts. We actually take this wax, we put it on with a soft cloth, very little, let it dry till it just gets a little bit cloudy, and then we go back in with a clean soft cloth and we really buff it out, okay? And this would be one of the ways that you would work to preserve wooden furniture. What we have next to it is actually some quilts that have been boxed up in the for the collection. And actually what you see is one quilt. This is the quilt right above here. And you can see that it's packaged. That's one quilt in that box, and it's a pretty big box. They take up a fair amount of space, each and on their own, because we want to make sure there's no hard folds. In order to do that, we're using acid-free tissue paper. This is an acid-free box, and these get crumpled up and rolled into each of those different creases so that it helps protect it, and we don't end up actually doing damage to the quilt by storing it. So these are just a few examples of kind of some of the things that I do. I also do a lot of the exhibit development here, the ideas and things like that, and we work on it. And I just spend a lot of my time helping out however is needed on any given day. Thanks.
Again, good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for being here. We're there. We've got lots of folks. Anybody who wants to have a seat, we got some seats up here in front, and right here as well. We're so pleased that everybody's here this evening to share in the celebration of the Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy Award. My name is Robert Harker, Director of the Sheboygan County Historical Museum. And today we take time to celebrate the important accomplishment. The Sheboygan County Historical Society and Museum has been awarded the prestigious Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy by the Wisconsin Historical Society Board of Curators. This trophy is awarded to the society that maintains a level of excellence in serving the community for at least 5 years. The presentation will be part of this program this evening. Of the 380 affiliate societies, we are designated number one for a year. It's an incredible accomplishment that is a result Thank you. It is an incredible accomplishment as a result of the community support, public and private, members and friends, and all of you in this room. This adventure began on Saturday, June 23rd, 2012, when an email from Michael Stevens was sent to me here at the museum. And Michael Stevens is right over here, okay? On Monday morning, that came on Saturday, but Monday morning, this is what I read on the computer screen. The Board of Curators just voted to give the Thwaites Award to your society. Congratulations. I'll call you Tuesday with details. Okay. So here's why this was, I didn't know what to think, because we had not submitted an application with the supporting materials. Quite literally, I sat quietly for a few minutes, contemplating the possibilities of sharing the good news and wondering if, in fact, this was a joke. I asked Tamara to look at the email for a second opinion. What we did not know at that time was that the Wisconsin Historical Society staff reserved the option to submit an application on behalf of an organization they know is serving the local community at the level required by the trophy guidelines. Michael called me on Tuesday with more details. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Within hours, an email was sent to board and staff, and the ideas for celebrating began to flow. Again, welcome. I would like to recognize those here today who support and guide the museum. I would ask that you hold your applause till we get through with all the groups. I would ask the members of the board of directors and the past members of the board to please stand and remain standing. We've got lots of folks here. Board members, don't be bashful, okay? You're going to be standing the longest. Okay, we've got lots of people. You represent the current leadership and all of those board members who help guide the society to this point. I would ask the current museum staff, former staff, and interns to please stand and remain standing. There you go. You represent those who are on the ground, getting the daily work done, along with guiding the efforts of volunteers. I would ask the current county board members, past members, and county employees to please stand and remain standing. Okay. And thank you as well. The supporting relationship since the 1930s has provided a place for the museum to be and has supported the development of the museum to what we see today. We thank you for that. I would ask the Historical Society members, volunteers, and friends who provide substantial funding and services to please stand and remain standing. There we go. There we go. There we go. Okay. Okay. The the volunteers and the record of accomplishments, which is on this wall right over here. Your support is fundamental to the success of the Historical Society and Museum. So at this time, just another tremendous round of applause for everybody who's... Thank you. You may be seated. I've invited four people to speak on behalf of the Historical Society and Museum. Each has a long view and a unique view of how the museum serves the Sheboygan County community. Beth Dipple, you're here? Yeah, you can start to come up here. Beth Dipple is the director of the Sheboygan County Historical Research Center. We often describe our efforts at the Research Center as the Research Center collects the stuff you file, which are the historical archives. We at the museum collect the stuff you dust. The fact is, we work together as if we're two parts of the same organization. Please welcome Beth Dipple.
Thanks, Bob. First of all, I want to say congratulations to the staff, to the volunteers, and to the board of directors. You've worked long and hard to earn this award. What an honor. Please think about it daily. We're the ones in the trenches with you guys. We see what you do. We know how hard you've worked to get to this point. So what an honor. And thank you to the Wisconsin Historical Society for recognizing the growth, accomplishments, and service of the Sheboygan County Historical Society. Good choice. Not that the others aren't, but good choice. As part of the Sheboygan County Historical Research Center, I've had the privilege of working with the Historical Society for nearly 15 years. As Bob said, ours is a unique relationship. We call ourselves sister organizations. We are really two separate organizations with much the same mission, and happily we complement each other rather than compete with each other. And actually that's sort of the theme that we follow throughout the county. It is really a complementary or many complementary relationships rather than competition. It works so much better that way. For those of you who might not know you can tell this is not what I do on a daily basis. Not my favorite place here. For those of you who might not know, the Historical Research Center is Sheboygan County's local history archive. It was started in 1983 by members of the Historical Society, the Jean Society, and Sheboygan County Landmarks Limited. It was designed to create a central location for research documents, all those non-vital statistic documents. Material came in from people's attics and basements, from businesses and storerooms, out of boxes and closets, and into the light to be shared by all. The Historical Society was key to the Research Center's success, and in turn, we work hard to support their mission and further their activities. The formation of the Research Center was considered an odd idea at the time. Many said it wouldn't work, but 29 years and a million documents and 600,000 plus photographs later, here we are. We like to distinguish ourselves between our organizations with this quirky saying, as Bob said, if you file it, it comes to the Research Center, and if you dust it, it goes to the museum. Now that may seem or sound simplistic, but what it really does is put it out there as a regular everyday saying, something that somebody who doesn't deal with us on a daily basis understands. It makes the point, and it's funny. Our organizations collaborate when it comes to collections, but also when it comes to programming, volunteers, and sometimes even board members. And it's that kind of collaboration or teamwork that has created such an amazing historical presence in Sheboygan County. The Sheboygan County Historical Society has been the leader in encouraging success for individual historical organizations. Bob always says that each individual organization, such as Plymouth, we'll take that as an example, does Plymouth's history best, and that is so true. You do the overall scope, you take a look at everything and try to support everybody, but each individual group does their own history best. But it also encourages alliances among all the historical resources, whether they're in Random Lake or Plymouth or Sheboygan or Oostburg. It is a model for others when it comes to quality and professionalism. It is an example we all try to follow. The Historical Society is also an organization dedicated to discovering how it can best serve the community and how it can make the greatest impact on its residents. Third Saturdays and its all-day school discovery programs are two examples of programs which do just that. They both, in Bob's own words, create the magic, which is what you strive for every day when you're doing local history. I've been honored to have Bob as a mentor and a sounding board for a long time. I've garnered an education working with him that no university could provide. We found friends and great colleagues in Nancy and Tamara, Angela, Joanne, and Dale. In closing, I want you to remember every day, and this is to the staff especially, how important the work you do is. Be proud of what you've created. We at the Research Center thank you for your friendship and congratulate you on your success.
Thank you, Beth, for your very kind words. They're much appreciated. Terry Yoho is the director of Kohler Foundation. Kohler Foundation has been a friend of the Historical Society and Museum and the historical community for decades. The foundation has supported a wide range of activities from restoration projects to the development of innovative programs, including the Local History Expo and Third Saturdays. Please welcome Terry Yoho.
Kohler Foundation does have a long history with the Sheboygan County Historical Society, and we've been honored to help in some of their programming over the years, most recently the Local History Expo and the Third Saturday programs. The Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy has found a most appropriate home, and we congratulate Bob Harker, the board, society members, and the staff and volunteers on this honor. The Sheboygan County Historical Museum and Society have a long and distinguished list of accomplishment. But what truly sets them apart is the passion, vitality, dedication, and talent of these people that these people put into their work, the work of safeguarding and presenting our local history, our memories, yours and mine, the stories of our businesses, our families, our farms, the material culture of our county, all preserved, documented, and saved for another day, another generation. And because of the work of this organization, these memories are accessible to all of us. This group provides a priceless service to the community, and they do it with limited resources, a small staff, a dedicated board, and an impressive team of volunteers. It is not an easy job, and we celebrate that they are being recognized for this great honor. The museum's mission is to collect, preserve, and educate, and indeed, they do that very well. What Sheboygan County child has not been touched by what this museum does? It is how we learn about our past, to respect and honor what's come before us, and to use that knowledge prudently as we move forward. We thank the Sheboygan County Historical Society and Museum for all they've done to collect and preserve our history, and we especially appreciate what they have done to make that history come alive and to proactively reach out and share it with all of us, our parents, our neighbors, our children, with all of us. Congratulations on being awarded the Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy by the Wisconsin Historical Society's Board of Curators. It's well deserved. It's where it belongs.
Thank you very much, Terry. I appreciate your comments, and we all do very much. Joe Sheehan is here. I know you're here. There you are, back there. There you go. Joe, Superintendent of Schools for the Sheboygan Area School District, represents one of many school districts from around the county who include the full-day student education programs at the museum as an optional part of the student curriculum. We promote the full-day student education programs as a day at school at the museum. Joe, please welcome Joe.
Thank you, Bob. On behalf of all the students of Sheboygan Area School District, but the whole Sheboygan County, thank you and congratulations. What you have been doing is a part of Sheboygan, and that's the heritage of who Sheboygan is and how we teach our students is the roots of Sheboygan. As you're walking through here, the strength of what has been Sheboygan and quite frankly will be Sheboygan. Part of that is knowing our strong heritage and our history. And that doesn't happen without, as you all stood by the time he was acknowledging people, it's all your efforts, so thank you. How they've earned it? Well, a lot of groups come to the school districts and say, here's our program, what can we do for you? Bob and company not only said, here's our program, what can we do for you? They said, tell us what you need and we'll develop the program for you. That's a huge mind shift change, and that's on your leadership, Bob. We now have all our second graders coming here for the pioneers of what it was like, and they actually split wood, and they come back with splinters and go, how'd you get that? Sure, you know, explaining to parents. They dip candles, and they walk away with hands-on things that they bring home. Our third graders, they do a trades. They go, what was it like to live back then and be a blacksmith? And what this group has done is made it hands-on. Our kids come back excited, second, third, and fourth graders. Fourth graders are Native Americans, and they work with beads. I don't know if you've ever seen what the students end up coming up with, but they come up with beads of art that they get to bring home after they spent the day remembering what their roots are like in Sheboygan. And this group's not done. They're looking at fifth graders, and we're looking at the Civil War, and what was the Civil War time period, and what was that like in Sheboygan. Bob, under your leadership, he came to us and said, okay, we understand money's getting tight. We said, yep, it is. How do we help you? They said, you have this common core standard you have to teach. Show us what the kids need to learn, and we will incorporate it here. And they did. And that what makes this incredibly unique. I don't know of another historical society that has done that to their districts, saying, tell us what you need, and we will build it. And they did. So you've earned it more than just a year. And hopefully they repeat it 10 years from now, that we'll bring the traveling trophy back. But on behalf of all the students of Sheboygan, the whole county, we really want to congratulate you and thank you.
Thank you, Joe. We appreciate your comments very much. And being able to serve that part of the population is a very exciting part to be able to do. When we can reach second graders and third graders and fourth graders, we're part of their lives at that point. And that's really powerful stuff. I could go on and on, but we'll stop with that. Thank you for your comments. Adam Payne, and you're right here. Okay, Adam, Sheboygan County Administrator has a view of all the county services provided to county citizens. The museum is just one very small part that fills both a unique and important role of collecting and preserving our local history and educating the families of today and the future. County support has been the foundation from which the society has worked to provide the level of service to the community that is being recognized here today. Please welcome Adam Payne.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, and congratulations. I can't help but get a little sentimental listening to the presentations and appreciating the tremendous time and effort that all of you have put into this historical society, your blood, sweat, and tears. I think of the keepsakes that we have at home from our parents or grandparents or great-grandparents and how we cherish them and how not everybody has those keepsakes. And to be able to come to a museum like this and get that hands-on experience, as Joe mentioned, or see some things that you just never recognized didn't come directly from the store. This is a very special place to Sheboygan County. I've been county administrator for 14 years, and as Bob said, demands for limited resources continue to mount, and the county board has had difficult decisions to make. And it's just tremendous, the collaboration and history that's occurred here. I just learned from some of the bullet points that Bob shared with me earlier that 1920s, 1930s, the museum was in the courthouse. I didn't know that. Perhaps I should have, but I didn't know that. World War II, it was moved out of the courthouse, the county courthouse, the new county courthouse, because there wasn't enough space. And this location was established. And you could, over the years, the tremendous progress that has happened here. And to me, in my experience, good things take time. Good things take time, and it takes incredible collaboration. And each and every one of you have so much to be proud of for this day and this award and this recognition and acknowledgement of the outstanding work that you do and the gift that you have given this community. So I want to thank you for the opportunity to be here to celebrate with you. Congratulations to everyone. And I certainly hope that the county board and everyone involved who's supporting this will continue to do everything they can. Congratulations, Bob, the board, and all involved. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. Appreciate your comments very much. Appreciate it. Dr. Michael Stevens from the Wisconsin Historical Society sitting over here quietly, taking this all in, is here tonight to present the traveling trophy and a framed certificate. He is a State Historical Society Preservation Officer and Administrator, Division of Historic Preservation and Public History at the Wisconsin Historical Society, has extensive responsibilities in the operation of the society. In addition to that, he has written many articles, edited many books, including Voices of Wisconsin Past series, Yesterday's Future, Letters from the Front, Women Remember the War, and Voices from Vietnam. I first met Michael. I'm going to have a little bit here, okay? It's fine, yeah. I first met Michael when I was a member of the Wisconsin Council for Local History Administrative Committee. I was there for 6 years, an organization that represents the 380-plus affiliate societies. He provided guidance and the larger view from Madison. We on the council provided insights from local communities from all over the state. I'm not exactly sure of what he thought of our efforts and initiatives in Sheboygan County, but I believed he was interested in how we were able to accomplish so much in creative ways and generate substantial local interest and support. He invited me to be a part of the education committee of the Board of Curators. For a few years, I had the opportunity to gain insights into other efforts around the state and the initiatives being developed at the Wisconsin Historic Sites, including the Wade House. And Michael, even though I was uncertain of your first email to us about the Reuben Gold Thwaites Award, I am so pleased that you are here to make the presentation of the trophy and the certificate this evening. Accepting the trophy will be Society President Mary Novak. Please welcome Michael Stevens.
Thank you, Bob. I've been a longtime fan of the Sheboygan Historical Society. Little did I know that I would get Bob all concerned about by that email. I was so excited for you when the Board of Curators met up in Bayfield that I pulled out my smartphone and immediately typed off an email to Bob because I wanted to be the first one to give him that good news. And next time I'll do that again on a Saturday cryptically if there's good news for you. As I said, I've been a longtime fan of the Sheboygan County Historical Society, and I've known Bob for quite a while. I remember getting a tour from him in early in his tenure here, and it's an organization that has really, really impressed me, and a really worthy organization of this trophy. Wisconsin Historical Society has been collecting, preserving, and sharing stories of our past since 1846. That mission sounds pretty similar to your mission as the Sheboygan County Historical Society, as one of our nearly 400 affiliates, has followed that same path. And tonight, in winning the Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy, I can't think of another figure in the society's history who best exemplifies the spirit we find here. Thwaites, man with kind of an unusual name by today's customs, was a small, slight little man. He was a newspaper editor, and he followed the great Lyman Draper as director of the society. Large shoes to follow. But much of what we see in historical societies, not only here in Wisconsin, but around the nation, a result of Thwaites' work. Thwaites had a much bigger vision for historical societies. He recognized the importance of collecting. He recognized the importance of preserving. But what Thwaites added to that mix was that sharing element, the importance of public programs, the importance of reaching out. Prior to Reuben Gold Thwaites, we had no affiliated local historical society program in Wisconsin. In fact, we had very few local historical society. Thwaites traveled the state in the late 1890s and the early 1900s, urging local communities to form historical societies to preserve that history on that local level. Thwaites was a scholar and published many, many important works, but also generated all kinds of programs. In the Historical Society building on the UW campus, he had this enormous sign put in the reading room that said, "We aim to be useful." Isn't that interesting? We aim to be useful. That the measure of their success was how well they assisted other organizations. And so in giving the Thwaites Trophy, we look at the components of collecting, preserving, and sharing. But the piece that is most critical in that evaluation is that service to the community. And that's one area that Sheboygan County Historical Society simply excels. It's an organization that's proved willing time and time again, willing to embrace change, willing to reinvent itself and make itself relevant for each generation. And there are so many, many different ways. I'm afraid to even mention some, but I'm going to leave some out. But some of the things that stood out to the awards committee, the way you use that personal connection with your holiday memories and department store displays, tying into the memories of people and then showing the larger historical story. Your Third Saturdays program is simply amazing. I was talking with your staff and volunteers and asking, what's your average attendance here? And she said, oh, about 250, 275. And I thought, I misheard that. Yeah, you mean 25, right? And no, about 250. But we did have a 570 one time. And I thought, measure of the success of this. Not many organizations have that kind of success. Going beyond the boundaries of your own mission, but working with other organizations, your local history expos that have involved many organizations. I think last year you had 18 different local societies, as well as the State Historical Society participating. So many, many different things. But if there's one thing that really stood out to the awards committee was your education program. And your superintendent said it so well, the fact that this organization reached out to teachers and said, what do you want? And will you help us define what you need? And then we're going to give you to that. That's so, so very, very rare. Aiming to be useful. Again, back to what Reuben Goldthwaites was talking about. 2,300 students in a year. Mind-boggling numbers. And the interesting thing is, I talked to, the other day, we had a meeting in Madison. I talked to a parent of a Sheboygan third grader, and she volunteered as a chaperone. She says, I was blown away. These kids were interested in this for 5 hours. I mean, it's hard enough to get a kid interested in something for 10 minutes, 5 hours of history. Wow. And that's going to be a message that's going to stay on and on and on. And we've seen some historical societies nationally, that kind of success pays dividends in the future. In the state across the Mississippi River, Minnesota, we have members of the state legislature there who remember great experiences they had at a historical society, and filmmakers who remember that kind of experience. It's going to be lasting. We aim to be useful. That's the key. And that's the success of this organization. Something's very rare here, this drive to meet the needs of your audience, not letting the pursuit of the perfect get in the way of the good. That kind of good Midwestern practical get it done piece. And so many, many people are responsible. It was touching to see everybody standing up here and being recognized, your members and your volunteers, your strong board. These are not things that one individual can do. A great, great staff that are enthusiastic, that clearly love their work. And I'm going to embarrass Bob, but you have one of the absolutely best historical society directors. I would go so far, not only in the state, but in the nation. You have amazing leadership.
So on behalf of the Wisconsin Historical Society's Board of Curators, I'd like to present you with this year's Reuben Gold Thwaites Trophy. And I think Bob is coming up to get the certificate.
Yes, he is.
So for you. And Mr. Harker. For you. Congratulations.
As was stated in the Sheboygan Press article, this award is the culmination of the work of many people who have been an integral part of our historical society and museum for many years. Some of the members of the board of directors have been here a relatively short time. However, Bob Harker has more than 20 years of guidance and foresight in leading us down the path to where we are today. Along with Bob, the staff members of the Historical Society and Museum are dedicated employees and offer countless hours of hard work, and in many ways have gone above and beyond what we can reasonably expect of them in the normal course of their duties. Many thanks to our board of directors. Their insights and individual expertise have been invaluable to the functioning of the museum's mission. And not to be forgotten are our irreplaceable volunteers who can be called upon at moment's notice to help in any capacity needed. And may I add, they do so joyfully. My time as board president has been a real learning experience. It has opened my eyes to the difficulties and intricacies of operating a first-class museum and how many people working together for a single goal can achieve the success in the form of this award. Thank you.
Michael, thank you for the comments, of course. You're just so kind. I appreciate that. I had a tear too here. Anyway, thank you so much for being here tonight. But I have one final request, because so many people in this room have been such a big part of the success of the museum, that we'd like to do a photo of as many people as we can get in it right after we get through here. So we invite everybody in the room to do this, but we're going to have Michael and Teresa right in here and the trophy, and then we want to have our speakers that were here next to us, and then the board members and the county. You come up here too and be a part of this. And then the staff, we want the staff around here, and then we want the volunteers around here. And if there's anybody else left in the room, then you can just enjoy the chaos. So it's going to take us a couple of minutes to do this. Nancy is somewhere here with the camera on the ready. So what we're going to do, we're going to move some of these chairs here. We're going to put a few chairs there. We're going to have the Reuben Gold Thwaites Award. So wrap it up. Thank you so much for being a part of this celebration. It's just a great thing, and I appreciate being a part of it too, and have the chance to be the director, be the quarterback. So.